Hello?
Good morning. Poland's
Good morning.
Here, and a huge audience that would like to greet you.
Thank you.
My name is Peter, and I have the pleasure of asking you a couple of questions about the new album, about the Björk Digital in general. But my first question is, we know that you've just finished the album, mixing, you're doing the videos, you're still working hard. How does your brain function at such a moment? Are you remembering every twist of the mix, every second of the song? Are you analytical? Do you have like little drawers in your brain?
I maybe felt like that 2 weeks ago. Definitely you go into, it's very different headspace to mix an album, for example, to write an album. That's a very, very completely different headspace. But I delivered it 2 weeks ago, and then, yes, after a few months of mixing, my brain was like a cabinet. But I think I've been relaxing and doing other things for 2 weeks, so I'm slowly like drawers are disappearing, and my brain is not wooden anymore. It's more liquid and flesh now, I think.
Could you elaborate on the multitude of meanings for Utopia? Are you an utopian person yourself?
I think everybody is. I think this is maybe not so literally about making an album about just optimism or the light. I think it's also about darkness, and I think it's more, Utopia is more about this wish that humans have to want to dream, and maybe you want to try to imagine what your life can be in 5 years or 10 years, and you go like, okay, this is my fantasy, this is my dream, and then even if only half of it comes true, that's enough. I think it's very important to have a manifesto or a recipe of what you would like your life to be, and I think even especially now with Trump and all these quite dystopian politicians, I think it's even more important that the people, they dream and they kick off their DIY cells in their bodies to drive them to come up with an alternative to the reality that the politicians are offering us. So I think it's, we all have a right to create our future, I think.
But do you also think that the human race in general is unfortunately rather lazy and not very forward thinking?
No, not at all. I think we're amazing, actually.
And what's your relationship with the world at large nowadays?
Can you be more specific, maybe?
Are you fighting the world? Are you at peace with it?
I don't know, a bit of both. I think every morning, I think it's natural to wake up every morning and you have to make your day, you know? If you just, I think that's a natural resistance. I think, we were made as, 100,000 years ago as hunters and gatherers. We were meant to be every day to be looking for food and walking around and having to earn a living. And I think it's a natural state for us to be in, I think.
How much of the Björk character that we, the public, perceive is actually true in your private life? Are these two very separate worlds, or do they mix sometimes?
I'm probably, I don't know, because I think everybody has a blind spot for themselves. And I mean, I think it's very obvious, especially with the theatrical outfits that I wear, and that for me it's like a creation or like a fantasy or but I mean, I think that's still real. I think that has also always been with humans. To be theatrical is like a really like a human need, you know, like when you see shamans or rituals that were done long time ago. I think that is real too. I mean, there is part alternative parts of us that we act out. It's an important part of our spirituality and our existence. But we can still wake up the next day and just, you know, be normal and have breakfast and feel a little bit scruffy or whatever. I think it can all coexist, I think.
So are you wearing a mask now?
Nope.
A pity. listen, how much mystery you would like to leave about your work? How much you're willing to comment? How much you would say, let's leave it like that, listen to the album, see the video?
I don't know, it's a bit of both, I think. I think sometimes I enjoy explaining. I think there's definitely a part of me that's very, like, a frustrated music teacher that likes to encourage, especially younger generations or children, to make music or show them that it's actually not so hard, or maybe press buttons in them where they want to make things. So that part of me that likes to tell stories like this. I have 6 younger brothers and sisters, and that's very natural for me to be like the big sister who is kind of like encouraging my younger siblings to do stuff. But I mean, I think also, so, I mean, I've done so many interviews since I was a teenager, and there are things I never talk about. Then sometimes I have said too much, sometimes I've said too little, sometimes, I think most of the time when I say too much, I will just make a new plan. So, for example, if I would share something that I feel I share too much, the next time I will do it in my own life, I will just create a new space that is hidden for everybody. So I think it's just an ongoing search or a journey to find out when you overshare and when you undershare. But I mean, I think we all are dealing with that, also just with friends and family and in our daily life. And should we share our secrets or should we not? And sometimes it's important and sometimes it's important to not share. So I think we just have to take it one day by day and do our best, I think.
You must be the most prolific collaborator in the world. Could you comment on two areas? Teamwork, probably working from scratch, just dropping off ideas, and you working alone, and then bringing to your partners a preconceived idea.
Yeah, I mean, I think with every person I worked with, it's been different. I think that's the most important thing, I think, is most of the time when I work with people, I first get to know them as friends, and as you know, all your friends are very different people, you know, like you do completely different things with different friends of yours, and you have completely different conversations and go to different places, and it's the same with collaborators. I like to think that after a while, when you know each other, you can mirror out in each other things that you couldn't give birth to on your own. So, that's my fantasy, I guess. And I think sometimes you can spot better in another person what that person has a potential to do than you can see in yourself. And I think people are like that with me too. So it's I think it's very mutual. I think it's also what's very, very important in collaborations is time. So sometimes I will meet someone and immediately do something with them. And sometimes I will know somebody for 10 years. And then suddenly we will do something, work together. So I think it's very important to wait for the right moment, to not be too greedy or premature, because then the idea will be stillborn. But I mean, to be honest, I it sounds like I know it all. I don't, and like everybody, I'm just trying to figure it out as we go. And every morning, just wake up and just kind of go with my instinct. Really, what's next? Yeah.
Two more questions on the subject. How much do you work by trial and error? And also, a successful collaboration, does it mean dropping off ego, artistic ego, personal ego?
I think that trial and error, it really, really depends what I'm doing. I mean, I do so many different things, like, for example, doing the flute arrangements on this album. I did a lot of flute arrangements I actually didn't use. And I was rehearsing with 12 flute girls. And we tried a lot of things and I changed them. And then we rehearsed for a few months. And then we would record it. And then I would like, after we recorded it, I would change it a lot and edit it on my computer. So, and then I would listen to it, and then a month later I would listen again and throw things that don't work. And so usually things like arrangements or my choir arrangements or string arrangements, it's like this, and it's like doing a huge jigsaw puzzle, and you are maybe 3 years making it and changing it and working on it a few times a week, And so it's, I don't know if that's called trial and error, but it's not something that just pops out, you know. And I think the opposite is maybe how I make melodies, which most of the time I'm just walking outside and they just come in one go, you know. But sometimes I work on them, sometimes I will forget about them, and then a year later they will pop up. And that's really interesting because they will maybe pop up when I'm in a similar emotional situation. And then maybe I will forget about that melody again. And then maybe 2 years later it will pop up again in the same emotional situation, and then I'm really happy and I can put, you know, the emotional location that I was in, I can identify it and write a lyric about it, and that's kind of fun. But I mean, I think it's with, everything's different. I mean, when you mix an album, that's a really different part of my brain, you know, like, for example, Vulnecura, the album I did before, was really painful to write, and but really easy to mix. It's like drinking water to mix it. And in this album, it was so fun to write, and gliding down a slide. It was so fun to write it with Alejandro. And then mixing it took months. And it was, and then I just changed into another character. I just become whatever person the album needs. And in this instance, I needed to be this stubborn person that just works every day for months. And I just don't give up. You know, I just become like a stubborn mom who's sitting by the hospital bed of the child, and I'm just not gonna leave until it's healed and cured. And so so it's really different. It's never twice the same.
When you mentioned the previous album, how much is Utopia picking up where the last album left? And also, how much the sonics of the new record would be different from the last one?
I think sonically it's kind of the opposite. It's very, it's a lot of flutes, it's very happy, it's very light and airy, it's very fluffy, with a lot of birds and flutes and synthesizers. It sounds like the wind, so there's a lot of air, like city in the clouds. So in that sense, it's opposite to Vulnecura, which was very heavy strings. The music was like rocks on the ground. Emotionally, it was lying like lying on the ground or something, the melodies. While the melodies on the new album are like fireworks in the sky. I think they were obviously, I think maybe what was most similar about the two albums is I did both of them with Alejandro Arca. And we worked kind of in the opposite way though, because on Vulnecura I had already written most of it when I met him, and he came after, well, no, I'd already recorded all the strings and all the vocals and everything, and I kind of knew what kind of beats I wanted where in the songs. And we sat down together and I explained it to him, and he kind of made it almost like a hired gun or something. And then towards the end of that album, we wrote Not Get Together, and that was more 50-50. And then on Utopia, there are a lot of songs we wrote 50-50 together. So we kind of wrote, I think, more of Utopia together. But it's the same balance, I think, as with production. It's kind of similar.
Valnicura was a very personal record, and the presentation on media like the Björk Digital Exhibition that we are at now was also very private, because it's kind of one-to-one experience. Obviously, Utopia will be presented in a different, by different means. Is it too early about to tell us about details, what you plan with Utopia as far as media are concerned?
I mean, I think already the first video is out, The Gate, and
we enjoy it. We enjoy it enormously here.
And I think that's a good example of where my new album is heading, especially the intro of that, the introduction. You can see sort of a utopian landscape and the flute. but I think also that song, especially emotionally, is like the stage in between Vulnicura and Utopia. In what you will see in the digital exhibition is a lot of the songs in the VR. I have a wound in my chest. It's like a metaphysical heartbreak wound, and then in the video of Family, it heals, and I get better. And in The Gate, the wound is becoming, it has changed into a gate where I can love people from and they can love me from. So I think that's, and that's why I chose that song to be the first single, because it's like the bridge from Vulnicura to Utopia.
On a personal note, I must admit that I just admire the very idea of using the most advanced technology to portray a very physical wound where your heart is. That's just a great idea.
Thank you.
How much of your work never actually reached the public?
I don't think that much, actually, because I think in the beginning, I mean, I was, as a kid, I was singing a lot on my own, and I never thought this was something I was going to share. Then I was in band for 10 years. And I just wrote the melodies and my lyrics in the band, and so I think I had a long time where I was like not balanced, you know, like I felt I wasn't expressing a lot, very small piece of what I was making. But I kind of liked it that way, because I was a very young mother, I had a child, and I was really, really, it was a very magical experience for me. And I was touring the world with with the bands, and taking my child to all these parks and playgrounds, and it was very magical for me. And I don't think I was interested in being so extrovert as a musician. But I think when my child was old enough, about 6 or 7 years old, I moved to London, and I think my subconscious maybe prepared for that moment. Because I made an album when I was 11 in Iceland, where I was like a child star, and I really hated it to be so extrovert and on a platform where everybody could see me presenting something that I didn't make myself. I felt like a cheat and or imposter. So I think something in me decided I was not going to do it again unless I could present a new world, my inner universe, in a more truthful way. And I think when I was 27 and I moved to London, something in me had synchronized that all the things I make, I would share. And instead of when I was in the band, I would write a lot of melodies and only some of them would be used. I would start just writing maybe one song every month or every 2 months, but using everything, you know, like all the films I watched that month, all the emotional things that happened to me that month, all the visual ideas I had, all the would go in the lyrics, all the color, if I was obsessed with yellow, it would be yellow, you know, like, and then try to take the whole, as much as I could of a whole month, and put it into 3 minutes of a pop song, and not write another song until I had felt I'd done that. And then I could move on and write the next song. So I think because I was so late, it wasn't until I was 27 where I did my first solo album, which I think is quite late. A lot of people do it when they're teenagers or 20. So I think by then I had synchronized it. So I think ever since, I write one song maybe every month or every 2 months. And it's just really natural. It's like full moon, kind of synchronized with the full moon, to be honest, or something like that. And it doesn't really matter what I'm going through, if I'm happy or sad or on holiday or working or whatever. It's just like a rhythm that's happening underneath me, I think.
There is obviously a time shift between an artist and the audience. The artist is mentally somewhere else. The audience is behind. Is there a term now in your work at all?
What's the last sentence? Sorry?
Do you think in terms of the word now in your work, in your art at all?
Well, I like this delay actually. I mean, I think at the end of the day, making music is generosity, and it's the same like with a friend. If I'm downtown and I'm inspired, how much I love a friend of mine, and I want to buy him a present or make him a present, and then wrap it up and give it to the person, there is a time delay on that, you know, like from the minute I think of it and until the person has the present, it can be a week or it can be months, and that's okay. I think the preparing of the gift is a beautiful thing, and I like the delay, and I try to, I think as older I get, I try to make it more as an advantage. You know, I use it like shelter. So, for example, when I was releasing the Gate video, it took us a year to prepare this. But by the time I share it with people, we are already working on the next video, which is very, very different. So there's, in a way, when you prepare something to the world and you share it, you can hide behind it, and there's shelter behind, because people think you are, right now people think I'm the Gate, but I'm actually hiding behind and I'm being the opposite. So I think it's a nice contrast that I try to not make it vulnerable, but I try to make it into a strength. But I mean, I think, to be honest, I try. I mean, a lot of the time it's difficult, you know, and it doesn't work. For example, it was a difficult decision for me to do Vulnikura and to decide that I was going to share with the world this kind of really sad story. And then by the time, I knew because of this time delay, that by the time I would be singing it for people, I would be on another place emotionally. So I would be writing very happy songs of utopia, and I would meet friends or relatives in the street, and they would be very sad in the face, worried about me, where they had just listened to a song that I maybe wrote 4 years ago. So it is interesting, but I mean, I think it's eventually everything moves on, and I'm very happy now that the Vulnikura period is finished, and I feel more natural in utopia. I mean, utopia has dark songs. I think that's the most interesting thing I think about paradise, is that it always has a snake somewhere. And all utopias from all different mythologies, we were doing research, me and James Mary, my collaborator, on cultures of South America and Indonesia and Africa and Asia, their idea of utopia, and also mythologies about flutes and spirits. And they all kind of share a similar story where the women take the children and escape and take the flutes and go to some island or somewhere where there is no violence, and they write very peaceful music, and then but then at some later in the story, always the males return with some violent reaction, and then you have to deal with that and somehow confront it, and then you end with a new balance between the light and the dark, and the woman and man, female and feminine and the masculine. So I think it's a very interesting. I like also the cliche of utopia, that it's kind of like it has this kind of it's like a Disney film that is like a Bambi film that has a monster in it, you know. There is it's like a very extreme contrast. I like that.
Here is my last question, and then I have three questions from the floor. On the subject of time and delays again, are you searching for a timelessly relevant art? And second part of the question, which music do you find relevant nowadays?
I mean, I think I'm a musician first and last, and what has changed my life when I was a child and teenager and grown up and still does is a pop song. And I, that for me is a very timeless thing. And most of my favorite songs, I have discovered them maybe 10 years after they came out, or 30 years, or very rarely at the same time they were published. So, I mean, of course, I am interested in this, and or I wouldn't be making music. But I'm not always thinking about it, though. I'm not like, I think if I was thinking like that, it would be paralyzing for me. I think I can only do my best. And I just have to write the best song I can every month and hope that in 50 years I will have some songs that will resonate. But I, to be honest, I don't think so much about it. I think it's, I don't know why, but I managed to zoom out and not focus so much on that. But I mean, I think also because I started singing live when I was 12 or 13 in bands, and I did that for a long time before I wrote my own music. Completely or made my albums. So I think a lot of what I do is about the moment, in that sense, when you do a concert and you're trying to react with people in that moment and connect in a concert. And that is a very different kind of a form of expression than the recording. And I love that contrast. I don't know. Yeah, I mean, obviously I could talk about this forever. There are obviously recordings of like performances, some are good, some not, you know. It's like anything. What music I'm listening to now? I have been listening to Chelela. I love her album. I've been listening to Serpent with Feet. I think he's incredible. And I've been listening to Jürg Frey, who's a composer from Switzerland. And a lot of other things that I'm probably not remembering right now.
We're talking to you from Björk Digital in Poznań, Poland. We pronounce the name of our country Polska. Can you pronounce it in Polish? Polska.
And what is Polska?
This is Poland. How do we do pronounce it? Polska. It's a very nice sounding word. So you're free to use it somewhere.
Okay.
And I have three questions from the floor of Bieg Digital in Poznań, Polska. First one, as a person with chronic anxiety, I found family VR very much a relief. First feeling the suffer and then seeing images of healing give such an amazing feeling and making me believe I can heal myself no matter what. I'm curious if this was aimed during making of Family VR.
Oh, thank you. That I'm very honored that VR managed to make you feel a little better. I'm very flattered. Yes, it was. I think we did the first VR videos. We did every VR video with different team, both technical and creative. And everybody were like really experimenting and seeing what is this new medium, what is effective. And we were very lucky that we got to see people react to it. The first exhibition was in Australia in June 2016. And then we were so, it was so amazing to see how people really, really emotionally reacted to the song. And what we found is the most hidden power of VR is some sort of a metaphysical healing or like how it can affect you on a such a visceral level. For us, family VR is almost like a yoga. Like you are, I wanted to go, you know, it's called the bridge that you do in yoga, where you put your hands behind you on the floor and lift your chest up to the sky. And then you are healing this wound in your chest and you're sewing it together. And then you stand up and you walk away and you are healed. So it was a very intentional to do that. I think with the music video, the normal one, like on YouTube or something like this, 2D, it is very much like the viewer and then you are watching something. It's like two separate things. But with the VR, it's so beautiful when the difference between the viewer and the song blurs. So you are like inside the song. And whatever you do to your body, it's also the listener can feel that it's being done to the person at the same time. So I really wanted it to be like this, almost like this kind of healing, metaphysical thing. So I'm very, very honored that it helped you to relieve some tension. I do Kundalini yoga. I've been doing it for 10 years, a few times a week, and I recommend it for anxiety. It's magical, Kundalini yoga. It really, the heavy breathing really goes to deep layers of your, tension and relieves it. So I would recommend Kundalini yoga.
Recommendation taken. Question from the floor number two. What's your advice for people who want to start a new kind of utopian life?
Yeah, I mean, I think everybody has a different utopia, you know? One person wants to live on the beach, and another person wants to go clubbing and take drugs, and next person wants a wife and children. I think we have all a very different You do, yes. And I think out of all the things in the world, I think what probably what is most personal is our dreams, you know, what we want. And sometimes it's really simple, actually, what it is that we want. I cannot really recommend anything. I mean, I think maybe it is, if I was to recommend anything, it's just to say, maybe this album for me to make Utopia was me saying to myself that I have the right to dream, or I have the right to imagine, especially after such a shock, like when Unikura was for me, it was like an end of one life for me. And it was difficult for me to believe that I could, I had the right to invent a new life. And I have. And that's what I could say to everybody. I think everybody is allowed to dream utopia or make a new life for themselves. And sometimes it's hard to like dig into the future with a very stubborn spoon. But you just have to keep doing it, and then maybe a few years later, what you wanted is there. So utopia is necessity, I think, for you to make your own future, to be the maker of your own future, to be active, not passive in that.
And the last question from Polska. If you can get a new technology which doesn't exist yet to use in your future work or maybe daily life, what it would be like? A magic carpet.
My thing is, like, my problem is I always think of too many things, and I'm the sort of person that I wish there was four of me to do, just to execute all the ideas I get, and I think sometimes I should just chill and take a break. But, because I think sometimes it's a little bit extreme, but, I think part of me is like, oh, I wish I could have three more bodies. One could now be with you in Polska and do this interview. And another one could be in the mountains writing music. And another one could be, at home relaxing with my family. But to be honest, I'm not sure I really want that. I think that would be a very scary world if we had many versions of everybody. So I think it's an interesting challenge have equilibrium and to make sure that you use the energy and your time that you are given for your lifetime in a balanced way, and manage to rest in between and rejuvenate. And so I would say that's a good challenge to learn how to deal with your body and do Kundalini yoga and swim and walk and whatever. So I don't know. I think I'm quite happy with the technology that is around,
Polska loves you. A big hug from all of us here.
Thank you.
And a round of applause.
Thank you.
Thank you, Björk.
Bye-bye.